Thank you, sir.
Very much. You were right. It's early in the morning for me. For me, it was 7 o'clock in the morning. And when it started 40 minutes ago, it was still dark. And right now, it's the light is coming up. We are getting daylight right now. I will be talking about the HoloLens as a tool for doing crime scene investigations. I will give a little introduction about myself and an introduction about the practical problems in crime scene investigation. And I will talk about the use of the HoloLens as a solution, maybe a possible solution to solve all these practical problems. And I will tell a little bit about future work. This has been mentioned already. Okay, this is not important anymore. I used to work for the Netherlands Forensics Institute. And this is an aerial photograph of the institute. There are about 600 people working in this. It's a national institute and it works for our country with 17 million people. At some point I had to leave the institute and I got the opportunity to become a lecturer and researcher at the Leiden University of Applied Sciences. I also got the opportunity to develop my own courses. And I'm happy, very happy now that I can combine my work in, as teacher with my research. The first experiment started in 2008. This is a very simple headcam. And that's when I started to explore possibilities with video recordings and mixed reality. It looks very futuristic. this was a helmet with two cameras and screens on which information could be projected. And the software was produced by the Technical University of Delft. And it was a very primitive device, but that is how it started my work on mixed reality. Our laboratory and our classroom is in The Hague, at a facility of The Hague Security Delta. That's an organization of companies and government agencies and universities who want to work on cybersecurity issues. And there's a small laboratory where people can do investigations of hardware. And here you can see a picture of the HoloLens. It's a head-worn device with a camera, range sensors, and information, virtual objects can be displayed on the look-through glasses. So let me talk a little bit about the practical problems in crime scene investigation that I want to focus on in this presentation. First, you have to work in a suit. You have to wear gloves, which makes it difficult to work. And you only have two hands. And you have to do the photography, the sampling, and making notes in this suit with your just two hands and gloves. This is not a typical crime scene. Maybe it is not a crime scene. It's just a suspicious situation. And you need experts to find out what's actually here. This can happen in our practice. You can have situations like this in a farm. What are these instruments? Are they for processing special food or medicine for the cattle, or is it maybe a factory for illicit drugs? And then are there any dangers? Is it safe to be there? So this is another practical problem for crime scene officers. This is an example of a chemical waste site. You can find this in our woods because we have lots of factories in the Netherlands that produce illicit drugs, and they dump their waste just in the woods. So you can find something like this on an early morning when you are walking around in the woods. And then if you want to investigate it, yeah, what is it actually? That's the next question. And is it safe? Well, in most cases, it's not safe. And then the police need suits like this to remove this waste. So it's a real big problem. And then, where are the forensic traces? What should be collected as traces to find the perpetrators while you are working in a suit like this? And forensic investigation is not just about murder. It could be an industrial accident. And for that, you also need experts. But how to organize this, how to get advice from experts while you are doing crime scene investigation. So there are also problems, practical problems in organizing the work. And it would be helpful if it was possible to communicate with experts on a distance and share images with them. Then a special case I want to talk about in this presentation is wildlife forensics. I have a cooperation with a Dutch colleague who is running the Wildlife Forensics Academy in South Africa. And in this academy, wild park rangers will be trained to deal with forensic evidence. This is another practical problem, how to clean up a scene like this and not destroying forensic evidence. And just how to get there is actually a problem. Is it still safe, or will there be further collapse of the construction if you try to approach? So if you want to make a working plan, how to do this from a distance? You cannot put labels or marks on objects in this scene because you simply cannot get there. This is another practical problem. We have learned already this morning about DNA evidence, but when you're searching for forensic traces on a crime scene, some evidence might not be visible, especially DNA traces. This is an example of taking a sample from a fingernail, and there's nothing to see actually. So this is how to explain in the court where you have taken this sample. So you need photographs like this, but when you are sampling, you are already using your two hands. So how to make a photograph? So you need a colleague to make the photograph while you're doing the sampling. But maybe this colleague is not there at the moment you are doing this sampling. But this is just a practical problem. This is another practical problem. Sometimes you need a special forensic light to visualize traces. And then again, how to make a photograph. And if you make a photograph, you get a black image like this. So in this image, you can see actually the traces, but you cannot see anymore the context, the exact location of these traces in this scene. And then again, another practical problem. While you are doing your crime scene investigation, maybe with one or two colleagues, there might be surprises. You might have started your investigation with a nice plan, with some hypotheses, but then you can have a surprise like this. You remove something, actually you are changing the scene, and you find traces from grass, from woods. So maybe this is actually not a crime scene, but maybe you have to look somewhere in the woods to find a real crime scene. This can happen when the body has been moved. So again, how to document this, how to change your procedures, how to inform your colleagues in the scene. And so I'm looking for tools to solve all these kind of practical problems. And that's why I started to do experimental work with the HoloLens. Again, a problem with just having two hands. It's normal to do some testing on the crime scene, in this example, to find out if the red spot is actually blood. But you're using your two hands and how to do the documentation at the same time. finally, once you have taken a sample, you need, what can you do in the documentation? In the Netherlands, we use these barcodes, and they can be very helpful. But it's not very nice to make a note with just these numbers. So it might be helpful if you can read these numbers automatically with some device. There are not just problems on the crime scene, but once you have finished all your investigations, you have to do a presentation in the courtroom. And this is typically how a case file looks like. It's just lots of paper. So that discussions in the courtroom can be complicated by this fact that they're just working with paper. This is a moot court session for our students. I'm teaching at the Faculty of Forensic ICT. And this is how we make our students aware of all these kinds of problems. We simulate court sessions. And finally, crime scene officers have to keep working on their skills. They have to update their knowledge. So what can they do? This is a common practice in the Netherlands. They organize sessions on simulated crime scenes, mock-up scenes. But how realistic are these mock-up scenes? And is it possible to reproduce the traces on such a mock-up scene to allow for comparisons of different types of techniques for doing the investigation? But this is again a practical problem. It's often solved now by using virtual crime scenes. I have an example of that. It's actually the same scene. You can enter your name as a student. My name is Julian. And in this exercise, you have to be patient. In this exercise, we will just explore the scene using a number of panoramic images. Clean scene, crime scene. The door will not open because first I have to do an inspection of the front door. There might be traces somewhere here. And indeed, there are footprints. I can zoom in. I can make a note. And it's there. Maybe now I can enter the scene. So this is for students. It's just for exploring the scene. They can make notes and the teacher can check what kind of notes they have made. So now you can look carefully around. You can take a lower position. Before you enter the room, you can check for so you have to make an effort to get a very low position. Now you can check what's on the floor. So this simulates a physical effort. You can go back up. Now I can walk in the scene. I cannot walk directly to the victim. I can make a second note. And in the end, once the student has finished, the teacher can check what notes he had made. And it looks like this. It's very primitive, very simple. This is the time. In seconds, and this is the name of the panoramic image, and here we can see the notes that I've made. Footprints, that's a note. Victim, that's a note. But this is a very simple example of an exercise on a virtual crime scene. But a virtual crime scene is still not like a physical crime scene where you have to make physical efforts. So how can we improve this kind of exercises? I will go back to my presentation. And I was thinking, is it possible maybe to make a combination of a simulated crime scene with a virtual environment? And that's where I start talking about mixed reality. So I want to have a mix of physical reality and virtual reality. Since January 2019, I've been working on demonstrations with the HoloLens for a series of user studies, interviews, and demonstration events. And I found three types of applications for the crime scene investigation, for training and education, and for courtroom presentations. In this presentation, I will not do a live demonstration like I did in the previous webinars, but this time I will show you a number of movies. You can also find these movies on a professional website. This is the first example. It's about a chemical waste dump site. It's a mock-up scene. And this is the scenario. I imagine that a colleague has performed already an inspection of the scene with a HoloLens, that he has left virtual markers on the scene and a virtual video screen with a video message for me, and then I can continue the investigation. That's what I will show you in the movie. So this is what it could look like. Here we have a virtual victim in a real room, and these are virtual markers explaining some blood pattern analysis. And this is again a photograph in a virtual screen that can be used for briefing purposes. Now I will show you a movie with the chemical dump site. This is the mock-up scene. There are already virtual markers, number one and two. There are some screens with photographs, and there's also a virtual screen with video messages. I can simply click on it with my hand, and then I can watch the movie to find out what my colleague has recorded. There's also sound, but it is in Dutch, so I will not play it. I will skip a little part. And once I'm ready with the briefing, I can continue the investigation myself. I also, and then maybe I want to add a third marker. I get my menu. I want to place a marker. Doing this with air tapping my fingers. I want to make a connection between two different objects in the scene. And now I've added a fourth marker on the scene. I also want to place a warning sign. That could be the finish. This is another movie. It's recorded with a second HoloLens. We'll start the movie. And it's about reconstruction of bullet trajectories. It's a mock-up scene, it's not real. It was filmed in our laboratory using the two HoloLenses. This is a mock-up bullet hole. I'm inserting a probe with an image in this bullet hole. The image is recognized by software in the HoloLens. I click, and there is a virtual bullet trajectory visualized as a cone. I can bring the probe to a second bullet hole. The image is recognized. I can click, and again, there's a second trajectory. Of course, these trajectories have to be checked by a ballistic expert. So I can bring in a warning sign that this has to be checked. Then I can look for possible positions of the shooter. There's a point where these bullet trajectories come to one spot. So that is a candidate for the position of the shooter. And I can bring in a virtual dummy. And again, can bring in an note that there might be gunshot residues on the sleeves of the shirt of the shooter. Very simple, short demo. It was filmed using a second HoloLens, so you can share virtual worlds with multiple HoloLenses. It's also possible with the HoloLens to film your own hands. It works with speech commands. So you can say commands like film or stop filming. And then you can film a procedure like taking a sample. And with the same HoloLens, it's also possible to recognize the barcode. So you will have a photograph of the sampling with a barcode mentioned in the file name of the photograph. And it makes life easier. we've also done some testing outside. We knew that the HoloLens can work very nicely indoor scenes, but how does it perform in outdoor scenes? And we found out that you need to do some preparation. You need markers, physical markers in the scene to make sure that the HoloLens can still map the scene. And for instance, in most cases, these physical markers can be provided by using objects like this. This is an example of how to use the HoloLens for students. In this example, a teacher introduces virtual traces in a scene, and then a student can try to find these traces by moving close to them. But this is a situation for the teacher. I'm starting the application. How it starts. Menu pops up. FTB is Forensic Toolbox. I bring in the logo of our institute. This is a virtual trace. It's symbolic. And I can make it invisible. Now the student can try to find it, and the trace becomes visible if the student moves close enough. I can bring in multiple traces so they don't look realistic yet, but in the near future I want to have realistically looking traces. This is actually how it works. HoloLens is continuously mapping the scene. This map is used for placing virtual objects. I can also bring in, I can hide traces behind physical objects. So I can make it really difficult for a student to find these traces. Student has to make physical efforts to find them. But now they become only visible if I move close enough. Search, there it is. At this moment, I'm giving for the fourth time my half-year course for bachelor students. I teach them what a crime scene officer has to know, to do, and to learn. I tell them you will not become a crime scene officer yourself, but I want you to understand crime scene officers, because you have to come up with technical innovations for these people. I also teach them about possibilities and limitations of simulated virtual and mixed reality. I teach them about the technology of the HoloLens and whatever is needed for developing a mixed reality application. This is the program of the course, 10 weeks of lectures, workshops, practical assignments, just to teach them the necessary basic knowledge and skills. And then there are 10 weeks for developing and executing a small innovation program. And in this program, they can spend about 200 hours for self-directed study and experiments. Here are some keywords. This is the software, CDS Studio Max for computer modeling, Unity for making the applications in the HoloLens. I teach them, actually they go to a facility of the police to create and simulate a crime scene themselves. They investigate their crime scenes, so they prepare crime scenes for their for other students, and the other students have to investigate it. I teach them about the HoloLens, Hardcore, Vuforia, serious gaming, but also about things like quality assessment, competence assurance, collaborative exercises, proficiency tests. And I organize many brainstorm sessions online with professionals from the working field. And thanks to Corona, now the world is used to video conferencing. And actually, it's now very easy for me to invite someone from the police or the court just to talk half an hour with my students. And that's very helpful. Here are some examples of innovation programs. One team demonstrated a tool for doing a technical explanation of an unknown building. You've seen in the movie that the HoloLens can do mapping of the scene. It's real-time mapping. But in this application, the user of the HoloLens can see a little model, virtual model, of the scene that is mapped by himself, and he can see also in this little model that floats before him how much he has explored already and which parts of the building has not been explored yet. Another group demonstrated a game for learning how to recognize an illicit drugs factory and what legal rules are applied for further actions. Another team demonstrated a virtual room for discussing documents, photographs, and video recordings with different experts. And then another team demonstrated the game for wild park rangers to learn about collecting forensic evidence. And I will show you a movie of that application. And then another nice demonstration was performed by a student working on with cloud services for image recognition. And he demonstrated an application where the user of the HoloLens can explore and scene, crime scene, and then the HoloLens tells him when an object has been recognized. This is a link to the Wildlife Forensics Academy. Actually, this building is now, at this moment they are making the construction for the academy. The building has started already. It's in the middle of a wild park. Students from all over the world are welcome to do courses in that facility. And the idea is that in this way they will get funding also to provide training to wild park rangers. And this is a little application that one group of students has prepared. They made a recording in the woods with this application. I will start the movie. Oh, there's sound in it. A little menu that can help to introduce objects in this scene. This is recorded and prepared at the HoloLens number 2. This is a virtual frog. And there's a bird. This bird flies around the cylinder, but in the student mode, you cannot see this cylinder. At this moment, the teacher is preparing the scene for the student. So there will be some animals, there will be some traces. This animal is not looking very realistic, but it can be improved. It's also possible to program movements, possible to make a virtual animal react to the actions of the user. Very simple model of a lion, not very realistic, but can be improved. Keep in mind that this is just a demonstrator. It's not a real application yet. Menus are not organized very well. The next group of students, they can work on improvements of this application. So in 1 or 2 years, this software will become much better. You can see the HoloLens 2 can be controlled with two hands. Yeah. And now they will bring in a trace, probably. Some rocks. skip some parts of the movie. Footprint. So you see it's a virtual trace, but once it is ready, the student can start this program in the student mode. Again, I will skip some of this video. Oh, I've tried. Sorry about that. This is still. This is the student mode. So the student is bringing in a sign for evidence, an evidence number. We found out in user studies that the user interface is very important. People like to work with the HoloLens, but if it's complicated to control the menus, then they lose interest. In this exercise, the student has to make the right selections of tools for collecting the evidence. So he has to make decisions about what to use, a swab, or a paper bag, or a plastic bag, or an, this is a swab. So the student made the right decision to use the swab for taking a sample of the blood. It's also possible to make photographs with the HoloLens, but you cannot make photographs while there's a video recording going on. HoloLens cannot do two things at the same time. This is a way to collect the footprint. Let me see how it ends. How much time was needed, what has been collected. Now the teacher can give feedback on the performance of the student. About our future plans, so every half year my students produce a number of these little demonstration projects. And every half year I hope that they also will make improvements in these applications. And some of the students also get internships at the companies to do further work on the, on these applications. I want to do much more user tests to find out what applications are actually useful. I want to use more voice control, and it's actually very simple with the HoloLens. It's also possible to do voice annotations using cloud services with speech to text conversion. I want to do more work on virtual rooms for discussing case files. There's a lot of interest for that, on training and education. And I found out that there's a huge demand for little applications on smartphones, because everyone has a smartphone. And that's why there are many possibilities. And that concludes my presentation. I want to thank you for your attention. And I'm open for questions, of course.